Yeah, let us all say amen.
Amen.
Let us all say amen again.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Salvation has been brought down.
Amen.
Meaning that it was not here. So the one who owned it and the one who could provide it had to bring it to us. Praise the Lord. Salvation has been brought down. If you have your Bibles, please turn to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, verse number 41. And while you're turning there, I'm glad to be here on this Lord's Day morning. Presence of Almighty God and in the presence of each of you. So that we can worship God together and encourage one another.
Yes.
I'm also glad to have some of my friends with me this morning who no stranger to us, the Norton family, brother and sister Keith Norton, but you know Keith, I just called him KK, first two initials. Then another gentleman of long standing, brother Mike Davis, he came our way this morning, South Union.
Yes.
Yeah, we've known each other since we were children, going all the way back to when he was running around North Wayside like I was running around South Union. That was back when youth ministries did a whole lot more joint activities.
Yes.
You know, it's good to have friends, but it's something special about having church friends.
Amen.
And, you know, it's just good to be aligned with like-minded people, not only in the professional not only in a professional sense, but in a moral and spiritual aspect of our lives as well. Y'all all right this morning? Y'all sure look good this morning. You look better than you did last week. Not to say you look bad last week. You just look better this week than you did last week. Which lets us know that God is still in the blessing business. Luke chapter 2, verses 41 through 46. I'm reading from the New King James. Listen to what the Bible says. His parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem according to the custom of the feast. When they had finished the days, as they returned, the boy Jesus lingered behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother did not know it. If you write in your Bibles or take notes, highlight that part of verse 43, and Joseph and his mother did not know it. But supposing him to have been in the company, they went a day's journey and sought him among their relatives and acquaintances. So when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem seeking him. Now, so it was that after 3 days, interesting, right? After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. Where is Jesus? Where is Jesus? In our passage, we see that Mary and Joseph went to Jerusalem every year because it was something that was customary to do to celebrate the Feast of the Passover. On their way back home, they thought Jesus was somewhere, but they only to discover that he was not where they thought he was.
All right.
So they, on their way home, have, you know, their child Jesus, couldn't find him. I imagine that somewhere during the course of that time they were looking for him, they either asked each other or asked somebody else, where is Jesus? I know when we hear that question, where is Jesus, some of us may immediately go to the day of his resurrection when the tomb was empty and no one knew where his physical body was. Where is Jesus? But in this instance, we're going to look at it from a different aspect. From the aspect of examining our lives and asking ourselves, where is Jesus in our lives? So where is he? We know that he's omnipresent. We know he's all-powerful. We know that he's all-knowing. We know that there is nothing that can stop him from being where we are. We know that there's nothing that can prevent him from shepherding us in the way that only he can.
Yeah.
So how is it that there is a disconnect from Jesus? How is it that Jesus gets lost? So let's answer, so before we answer that question, let's look at something that occurs in the text to help us to better identify how Jesus can get lost in our lives. When did Mary and Joseph lose Jesus? They lost him after the celebration. What celebration did they lose him after? The celebration of the Passover. And my church family, what I suggest to us today is that sometimes when we do lose Jesus, it's after the celebration.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean by the celebration, Brother Thorn? This celebration that we're taking part in right now.
Mm-hmm.
See, while we're in the building singing and honoring him, both through our offering and communing with him, mm-hmm. and praying to him and reflecting and meditating on it, he's on our mind right now.
Mm-hmm.
When we hear the voices uplifted, we see the smiling faces, we hear the amens and the hallelujahs, we're celebrating and he's on our minds right now.
Yeah.
Likewise with Mary and Joseph, this was a celebratory event, the Feast of the Passover. And the Passover event aligns with the work that Jesus did on the cross for us. How is that? Because in both cases, blood was shed to demonstrate God's dominance over death.
Mm-hmm.
Are you all listening this morning? We know the story in Exodus, right? How in order to prevent the firstborn from dying, God's people were told to kill the firstborn of their flock and to put blood on the doorpost. And that shed blood on the doorpost spared the lives of their firstborn. Well, likewise, when Jesus shed his blood on the cross and resurrected, he spared, amen, somebody. He spared our lives spiritually. And so we come together because of what he did, and we celebrate that. However, I contend that like Mary and Joseph, when the celebration is over, Jesus sometimes gets lost. How is it that he gets lost? How is it that a Jesus who is all-powerful, almighty, and all-loving can get lost? Because, simply because, like Mary and Joseph, we forget to check in with him on a regular basis. When I was a kid, things were a little bit more relaxed, but my parents had a rule that if we went outside and played, and if we were not in their front yard, every so often we had to physically check in. We couldn't call on the telephone. They wanted us physically to come back to that house and say, Mama and Daddy, I'm just checking in like you told me to. And I'm going back to where I was, whether it was at a friend's house down the street or my grandmother's house who was a couple of blocks away or wherever it was. If they said check in every 15 minutes or every 30 minutes, we physically had to go and check in. And what I want us to think about, my church family, is how often do we check in with the Lord?
Mm-hmm.
How often do we make time to talk to him and allow him to talk to us on a regular basis? Ongoing regular communication, as we have discussed before, results in the closeness of relationships.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the Lord God started the conversation. How do we know he started it? In John chapter 1, verse number 1, the Bible says, "In the beginning was the Word." What is the Word? The Word is the communication of an idea. He began the communication in the beginning. In the beginning was the Word. And we know how the rest of that passage goes. The Word was with God and the Word was God. And as we scroll down to verse number 14 in John chapter 1, the Word was made flesh. Who was the Word made flesh? Jesus Christ. Jesus started the conversation when he left hell. Amen, somebody. So the conversation started with him, with God. And so it is up to us to keep the communication going. But the thing is, to keep that disconnect from happening, just like we want God to hear us, we got to be willing to listen to him.
Yeah.
How well do relationships work when there's only a one-way communication stream? How effective are unions when a person is only being told what to do and never hearing what the other person has to say? How do we treat people who only show up around us when they need a favor, when they need some money or need us to do something for them? We ain't trying to hear all that.
Amen.
Because they wasn't around any other time, but all of a sudden they in the jam and they want to show up.
Yeah.
Well, don't we believe that our Lord has feelings?
Yeah.
Don't we love him enough to understand that even though he is given, he wants some reverence in return?
Yeah.
Don't we know enough about him just using our common sense that we should treat him the best way that we possibly can. However, when we do not treat him properly, guess what? He gets lost in our lives. Secondly, in addition to forgetting to check in, we neglect to keep him in front of us. For those of us who've had to babysit or manage small children before, when we go to crowded places, we keep those small children in front of us. Why is that? Because we don't want anything to get between us and them. We want to keep them in our line of sight so that we will know where they are at all times. Evidently, from the passage, we can see that Mary and Joseph did not keep young Jesus in front of them. They just allowed him to move around as he pleased. And likewise, church family, when we allow children to move around as they please and don't keep a watchful eye on them, they can get lost. Yeah. They can physically get lost. Yeah. They can get kidnapped. They can get morally lost. Yeah. And most importantly, they can even get spiritually lost if a person who is responsible is not keeping their eyes on them and teaching them the ways of the Lord. Right. So my brothers and sisters, how is it that we keep Jesus in front of us? Well, let's remember what the Bible says in Colossians 1:18, that he is preeminent. That means he's first in all things. Where is he in our lives? Is he first in all things? Colossians chapter 3, verse number 17 teaches us that we should do all in the name of the Lord. What do we mean by name? With the authority of God. Do only those things that God authorizes. How does that work together? If we respect him as being first, then we will all then, because of his preeminence in our lives, it then dictates our thoughts and our behavior. Because he's preeminent, because he's first, or let me say it the way the religified folks say it, right. If he is Lord of your life, oh, we remember that phrase, don't we? If he's Lord of our lives, then guess what? There's no disconnect. Why? Because he's in our line of sight at all times, and we're taking instruction from him in our thought that impact our thoughts and our actions.
Yeah.
How does Jesus get lost? Where is Jesus when it comes to our lives? We have forgotten not only to keep him in front of us, not only to check in, but I believe, church family, sometimes we forget his worth. In the 6th chapter of Matthew, and you can read that whole chapter when you get home, we read about him being a provider for us when nobody else does. We read about him showing up at a bird's funeral. He's even told us if the grass doesn't have to worry about being fed and taken care of, then we don't have to worry about it either. He's our provider. Do we forget that? Do we remember that? Do we forget that? Do we remember that? Do we remember how valuable he is when it comes to our existence? Not only that, how valuable is he when it comes to our spiritual lives? How valuable is he? He's worth God's love. If God's love was currency, Jesus would be it. Not only that, in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 and following, we see that his blood was so valuable that it outweighs everything of value on earth, which was used to buy us back from our sinful oppression. Hey, y'all got me? But y'all still looking at me like I'm speaking Hebrew or Arabic or something. If we value our relationship with God, if we value the forgiveness that we've received from our sin, then that should cause us to keep Jesus on our minds each and every day.
Amen.
When we forget that value, guess what? Then Jesus gets lost in our lives. If we value having a home in heaven with God, then no one has to remind us about Jesus. If we value God's unconditional love, nobody has to remind us about Jesus. If we value the grace, the unlimited supply of grace, the unlimited supply of mercy that we receive as a result of being a child of God, then nobody has to remind us of Jesus, and therefore he does not get lost in our lives. Am I making sense this morning?
Yes, sir.
Gee, where is Jesus? Because we see in Luke 2 he was missing, And we also can be, see in 2022 that sometimes in our lives, he can be missing. Mm-hmm. How valuable is Jesus to us? I'd like for us to briefly read Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19 and following. In Hebrews chapter 6, listen to what the Bible says. In Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19 and 20, the Bible says, "This hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, which enters the presence behind the veil, where the forerunner has entered for us, even Jesus, having become high priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." This hope, do we see that phrase, this hope? The Bible, the Hebrew writer says, this hope we have is a sure and a steadfast anchor. We know about anchors that are attached to ships and that are attached to boats. When anchors are dropped, those vessels don't move. Why? Because the anchors are sure and steadfast. Amen. And what keeps the vessel from moving? It is their connection to the anchor. Amen. And if we are connected to Christ, and Christ has entered the presence behind the veil, which we know is in heaven, sitting at the right hand of his Father, yeah. And if we are connected to him, that communicates to us that our hope is sure and steadfast. Why? Because we're connected to Jesus, who is our anchor. Yes, so church family, going back to the question that I asked earlier, how valuable is he to us? If we understand that we have an immovable, a sure and steadfast connection to our salvation because of our relationship with, y'all got this by now? Because of our relationship with him, to me that communicates value. As long as he's on the other end of my rope, I know that everything's going to be all right because I'm connected to a sure and a steadfast anchor.
Amen.
Where is Jesus? When they realized he was lost, Mary and Joseph, they turned around and looked for him. They looked for him among their kinfolk. But guess what? They didn't find him. And what I want to suggest to us today, church, is when we realize Jesus is lost, let us not go look for him in the wrong places. They went to their kinfolk. I don't think y'all believe this. Let's go to Luke 2 again. 41.
Yes.
42 actually. And when he was 12, they went up to Jerusalem according to the custom of the feast. When they had finished the days, as they returned, the boy Jesus lingered behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother did not know it. But supposing him to have been in the company, do we see that? Guess who the company was? It was their kinfolk. Why do you say that? Because they all were descendants of Abraham. And sometimes, church family, when we realize Jesus is lost in our lives, we start looking in the wrong places. Yeah. And guess what? Like Mary and Joseph, we don't find him. Our families can pull us in the right direction, but our families are not Jesus.
Yeah.
Our family members may have elders who have provided years of wisdom, experience, and stability. But guess what? Big Mama and Papa ain't Jesus.
Amen.
And neither is Uncle Ray Ray either. But it doesn't matter how highly esteemed or accomplished our family members are, they are not the Messiah.
All right.
But just like in this instance where Mary and Joseph couldn't find him among their families, Jesus is missing in our families and our communities today. How do we know that he's missing? Well, when we don't see his attributes, we know that he's not there. How do we know that we do not see his attributes? Well, one way we know is when the only thing that is revered is the will, the personal will and desire of individuals. In the societal climate that we're in now, The notion of saying, I'm willing to sit second chair for the greater good, that doesn't exist anymore. Do I have a witness this morning?
Yes, sir.
It's not as commonplace as it once was.
Right, right.
It's all about people wanting what they want and getting what they want regardless of what they've got to do to get it.
Wow.
How do we know that he's missing? The misuse of the rainbow. In Genesis chapter 6, that rainbow signified a promise that God made to man that he wouldn't destroy the world with water again. But society has taken that symbol and has attached it to an immoral lifestyle that heaven does not endorse. How do we know Jesus is missing? Because as individuals, we sometimes put more value on our personal accomplishments than the atonement for our sin that we're able to get only through Jesus Christ. How do we know that he's missing? When we look at the way our families operate, in some homes, there's no clearly defined order between parent and child. It's an anything goes type environment, and you don't know who's in charge and who's not in charge. How do we know Jesus is missing? When we look at the lack of discipline. And when I say lack of discipline, I'm not just talking about correction, but individuals living a disciplined and controlled lives. In other words, some people are not disciplined with their spending. They believe as long as they have credit, max it out. Some are not disciplined with their eating. They believe as long as food is on the table, gorge until you make yourself sick. Some people are not disciplined when it comes to pleasure and having a good time, so they just go and go and go and go and go, and other aspects of their lives fall apart. One of the attributes of being a child of God is living a disciplined life. And sometimes, my brothers and sisters, Jesus can even get lost among church folk. In John chapter 13, 35, we know what that passage says, don't we? That they will know who we are by the love that we have for one another. Does our love for each other measure up or align with the love that Jesus has for us? How does our love for one another compare with the love that Jesus describes in John 13, 35? Is it the type of love that would say, yes, they're being controlled by the Lord? Or is it the type of love that's transactional like it is in the world that we live in? Where is Jesus? Where is he? Do we know where he is? And if so, how do we find him? Well, when we realize that he's missing, then we got to do what Mary and Joseph did. And that is turn around and find him. How do we know that he's missing? Because his attributes are invisible. How do we know that he's missing? Let me say that again. Because his attributes are not visible. But the key is, we got to turn around and find him. We got to turn around and find him when we know that criticism has curtailed the creativity of struggling Christians. We got to turn around and find him when we see care, compassion, and concern being constrained by the cliques that we are a part of. We got to turn around and find him. And it is important for us to find him because it is only when we find him that we have some help dealing with our issues. When we find Jesus, he's strong and mighty enough to remove our issues. He's mighty enough to help the spiritually lame to walk again. He's mighty enough to give sight to the spiritually blind. He's mighty enough to set the sin-oppressed person free. He's mighty enough that even if we're crazy, he can clothe us and put us in our right mind. But the thing is, if we want to have that inner peace and contentment like Brother Massey talked about in Bible study this morning, the only way to do it is to make sure that Jesus doesn't get lost.
Amen.
But the key is when the amen is spoken at the benediction, we can't leave the celebration in the building.
Amen.
We got to take that celebration on home with us.
Amen.
And by taking that celebration on home with us, guess what? We keep Jesus in front of us at all times. We are his people.
Yeah.
We are the sheep of his pasture. As the sheep of his pasture, we conclude that he's our shepherd.
Yes,
the shepherd leads the sheep out to pasture.
All right.
And if he's a man, somebody, and if we take the celebration with us, We keep him as our leader, and we do not allow him to get lost in our lives. So before I take my seat, I challenge each of us individually to ask ourselves, where is Jesus? I'm not talking about the person who's on the street getting drunk and high. I'm not talking about the person whose homes and lives are all torn up. I'm talking about each and every one of us individually to take a moment to reflect and ask ourselves, where is Jesus? It's so easy for us sometimes to make ourselves the standard when we look down on people who are different from us.
Yeah.
But guess what? You ain't helping them by looking down on them, and you ain't helping yourself. We not helping ourselves either when we do that. The key is look at ourselves.
Yes, sir.
And allow the Lord to have his way with us.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we're able to positively impact the lives of others.
Yeah, yeah, bro.
Where is Jesus?
Mm-hmm.
Is he absent because we're not taking him with us? Is he absent from our homes because we've left him out? Where is Jesus?
All right, bro.
Before I close, if someone here has not yet become a Christian, I ask you, where is he? If you want him in your life, you do that through faith, repentance, confession, and baptism.
Yeah.
Baptism for the remission of sin, and the Lord asks you to his body. And then for those of us who are Christians, where is he? I know we may be in influential positions at work, but I'm not asking you about your work. I'm asking you, where is Jesus?
Right.
I know you might be well accomplished. You might even be so accomplished that your name is a household name across your community and maybe even across the nation. But where is Jesus?
Driving home.
You might have people who respect you for various reasons, but their respect is not what's going to get you into heaven. Where is Jesus? You may be known as the prominent church goer on your block, but where is Jesus?
Amen.
Coming to a building on a regular basis doesn't mean that he's the top priority.
Amen.
It just means that you got a good habit and a good routine. Amen, somebody.
All right, bro.
Where is Jesus? Go ahead and stand to your feet right now.
I wonder if I